Steve.
This is Bob.
This is Jay.
We are Alpha Quadrant 6, a science fiction review show, and we are doing an after show for Star Trek Discovery. We just watched Season 2, Episode 11, Perpetual Infinity. And man, the season is ending strong. I think it's been solid.
This episode, I kept saying to myself while we were watching it, this is like a thriller.
Yeah.
It was tense. It was a little scary in a couple of moments. You know, you didn't know what Leland was going to do. I really liked the AI taking him over. Yeah. That was really cool.
Yeah.
And it was the first time that any AI has like a computer was moved into, like a digital brain was moved into a biological
with nanites.
That would be the only way you could do it.
Yeah,
with bad nanites. They were the bad ones.
Evil so nanites.
I would imagine that what's happening in there is first it's a way for the machine to have, you know, put its consciousness in there inside.
I think he just took over his brain, just replaced, overrode his brain.
So you think Leland is dead then?
Leland's dead. Leland's
I guess
gone.
Leland is dead.
Yeah,
probably.
You know, there's no way.
Not necessarily, but yeah, probably.
But what was it doing when it was like sitting there, like with its, like it looked like parts of his face were open and stuff? Like what was happening?
Hygiene? I don't know.
Yeah, whatever. Pun maintenance.
Yeah, something weird was going on. Yeah, but like, you just think like it wants to hide itself. It's kind of like the Thing in a way.
Yeah,
you know
right.
What I mean?
Yeah.
Well, Darth Vader had his helmet off and stuff. I mean, you know, he was doing a similar thing. He had his face off. Mm-hmm.
But I can't help but take it to the next level where I'm like, well, Leland was like hitting people. You know, he's fighting with George O.
Yeah, so the nanites are enhancing his body. It's not just taking over his mind.
But he could be infecting other people too, you know? Like it could be insidious.
Insidious, yeah.
Yeah, there was a second there in that fight where George O did something that made me, it looked like she was shaking off something like
that. Yeah,
he infected her. But I don't think so. Yeah. But I did think that for a second.
And man, George O, like, she is so perceptive. She picked up that it wasn't him right away.
As soon as he came on the bridge.
Yeah.
They cut, there were two separate times to show her face like, And then when Tyler left, she walked up to him and goes, "You're very resolute today."
Yeah.
She is so on the ball. It's amazing. Yeah. I love her even more after this episode. She's just so intriguing. One thing I didn't like though about her is when she was talking to Michael's mom, and Michael's mom, who's like the master of time, right? She just knows everything. She's like, "Thank you for watching after my daughter, and you have sacrificed yourself over and over for her." And I'm like, you really didn't have to say that, because we kind of were suspecting that that's what's going to happen. She's going to have this nice arc, and now it's like it's definitely going to happen now. So it's going to, I don't know, reduce the impact.
I don't know, a little foreshadowing like that is okay.
It needed to be a little more subtle. You know, I get what Bob's saying. Like, don't. It was very ham hockey. You know, it's like you're going to become a good person eventually. You know, the future episodes that you're going to be involved in are going to have conflict between them.
Well, not necessarily, because it's context dependent, and there may be situations in which she would sacrifice herself. Yeah. You know, for Burnham, but in any case, it was I think a really solid episode. Again, the action level was great. Uh-huh. I think the plot was good. And again, any time when you're not seeing everything coming a mile away, where there's any unpredictability, is great.
Right.
Yeah, I like the fact that the AI took over Leland, and you know he was, you know, doing a good job with the AI of manipulating Tyler and Georgiou. Tyler clearly bought it, although he wasn't uncomfortable with it. Georgiou was doing what he asked, but was kind of suspicious. But she still did it, though.
I was surprised when she put that little device on the thing.
So she wasn't sure until Dr. Burnham, you know, Michael Burnham's mother, said he considers me, you know, a threat in the same way, a threat to the mission.
Yeah, the larger mission,
and that echoed exactly what Leland said. So then she sort of pieced it together.
Yeah, that's
that
perfect.
Point.
Favorite scene, guys? I love the scene early on where she actually, you see what happened when she disappeared.
Yeah.
She put on the suit for the first time, and she goes, she wanted to go, I think an hour? She wanted to go a little bit into
the future. Yeah, what happened? Why did she go 900 years in the future?
Hey, man, this is, you know, new technology, man.
She was rushed.
So she's 950 years in the future, and you see her in the suit, and the wings, you know, the time wings unfurl. That looks so cool. She's interfacing with the computer, and then she goes from planet to planet, Vulcan to Earth, and everything's devastated. That was a powerful, interesting scene. I love that scene.
So I have a question. I need you guys to clarify something. So I don't understand why. So she goes forward 900 years. Now, is that her new...
That's her new home base. Yeah. That's her new home base, temporarily.
But why can't she just go back in time? Is it always...
They didn't really explain that.
Yeah, it didn't make, that didn't make sense.
You just gotta accept that. You know, why can't she make a new home time? And maybe she could if she had more time, you know, better tech. I don't know, but...
It's unclear.
They didn't super clarify that. Yeah, but that's okay. She's clearly locked in that time period. When she leaves, she always rubber bands back. They'll have to figure that out somehow.
I think one of my favorite things about the episode was Giorgio figuring him out. I love that because it developed her character a lot.
Yeah.
Just that one idea that she was able to see through that deception where everyone else couldn't. I liked the fight that she had with him.
Yeah, she went toe-to-toe with his nanite-enhanced... you know, strength.
And you know...
And she was tough as balls.
That actor can fight, right? Like, she is, in real life, a badass. Mm-hmm. And I was just...
Awesome.
I was hoping to see more kung fu during that scene, because I'm thinking of...
It was good, though.
Yeah, I know kung fu.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. But no, that was fine. I mean, it was cool. I could see, like, she the actor, had to hold herself back. She's way better than that. You know what I mean? Like, she decimated that.
I remember reading that. Decent choreography. The way he would dodge it, you know... Dodge her kicks and stuff.
His reflexes were super fast, which makes sense.
I like that Tyler got stabbed. Like, the stakes went high.
Yeah, like, there was a moment there.
It was a good stabbing.
Are they going to kill him off this episode? I mean, they could plausibly kill him off, you know.
But as soon as it was a belly shot, I'm like, you want him dead? Stab him in the eye. Come on. Belly shot?
Well, I just thought it was cool because it gave him that moment where he called up Pike and said, Leland, you know.
Yeah, one word.
And that's when it turned into a thriller for me. It's like, people are getting murdered. You know, like, there was a lot of intrigue going on. So
red shirts getting killed left and right. And we saw some good phaser rifle action. That was sweet.
That was powerful.
That was nice, man.
Yeah.
They've been weaving in things that they've been dropping in previous episodes, which is important, right? So we find, you know, it's a lot of different data points. You know, one, that Michael lost her parents. We didn't know why. You know, that goes back to last season. You know, why was she orphaned? The Spock's connection was woven in here. You know, we got to see that her mother jumped. Like, you know, we figured out like kind of the pathway that the mother took.
And yet, this is where they do a good job of arcing out a season. We knew we would get to this point. We pretty much have all the pieces to the puzzle, except we learn that Dr. Burnham is not responsible for those signals. So that creates another mystery, which is great to drop another mystery on us at this point. So now it keeps us in for the next three episodes.
Yeah, definitely. The show 24 was famous for that. You think, you know, and it's earlier. It happens earlier in the season where they're like, here's the big bad. Oh, this episode 3, we got the big bad. Oh, he's not the big bad. Here's the big bad. So they
keep
in the mystery.
In it.
It's funny, too, when you get towards the end of a season, especially in shows like this, because, like, we know it's going to come to an end, and then we're going to have some type of changing of the guard is going to happen, right? And I don't want to say... upset people out in the internet. I mean, but some, you know, and I'm trying to forecast now. Okay, we're close enough to the end now. Yeah, you know, I can see the final gate coming up, and like, what are they going to do? Where are they going to go with it? Are they going to defeat what are we calling the computer?
Control.
Are they going to defeat Control in this season? Is it going to bleed into next season?
I think, you know, they're pretty good at wrapping up that season's plot. I predict they're going to kill off Control. And then we'll maybe the last episode will be introducing the plot for next season, or there'll be some kind of transition. So we have, you know, three more episodes. We'll have two episodes of wrapping up this plot, and then we'll have an episode of transition, is what I suspect, which is good. It's good. It's a good arc. It's good writing. The season started a little slow, but now it's rocking pretty hard. I like it.
Yep.
I have no
complaints. Like, it's good.
It didn't take me out. I didn't get taken out.
Yeah, it's hard to go through a whole episode without being taken out. There was one little techno babble segment that we talked about.
Yeah, I like to listen to that.
Okay,
again.
The quantum this and the gravity, we're going to pull her out. It's like dark matter thing. Yeah. Okay, whatever.
It was cool, though, because it did make Spock say, I like science.
Oh, yeah.
That was great fun.
All right, I think my favorite scene was a very non dramatic scene, but I think it was at the end when Spock was talking to Michael and he's setting the chessboard.
Yeah.
Right.
And it just implied a lot. Like, Spock keeps coming back to the table to sit with Michael. You know what I mean? He wants to have this relationship with her, which I like. You know, we want to know that the human side of Spock wants these relationships. Mm-hmm. He knows that his sister saw her mother. And that was hard for her. He knows that she just lost her mother again to time. He's also appealing to her at the end as a Starfleet officer, saying, "Hey, the future is not written. I don't care what's
now is all that matters.
Yeah, now and the decisions we make now shape the future, but now is important." I like that he went in there and counseled her, and then let's play a game of chess and talk about what to do.
He basically said, "There is no fate but what we make," right? Totally Terminator,
right?
Yeah,
did remind me
absolutely,
of that,
absolutely Terminator. And again, they're arcing her relationship with Spock, Burnham and Spock as well. So
yes.
He was mad at her beginning and didn't really respect her, and it was like,
it's not all about you.
Yeah, it's not
Michael.
All about you. Hello. Yeah.
Well, it is, because she's the star of the show. But
you're not responsible for the war. You weren't responsible for the way that me and my family were being treated, et cetera. Don't put it all on your shoulders. And now he's realizing that she actually is processing her own emotions better. He's coming to a more respect, which is like the closest you get from Spock to affection. Though we know it's not really true, but. I think the actor playing Spock is doing a fantastic job.
I don't
doubt him as Spock.
I love him as young Spock. I think he's doing a great job, and so much so that they've got to give us more. They can't cast him so well and have an actor that's ready, willing, and able. I mean, what's funny is I am reading stuff online, and I'm picking up little tidbits of the actors want to continue to play these characters.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Which
Pike and Spock.
Yeah, it's always a good sign to know that they're into it. They're appreciative. And they're dropping hints if you happen to come up with another season, I would be down for that. Who wouldn't want to play Spock?
You're doing a good job.
A little spin-off? I mean,
Bob,
lesser
shows have been conceived. They've got it all right in front of them.
All right. So right now,
yes.
What would be your dream spin-off or direction for Discovery at this point? So we know there's going to be a spin-off with Section 31. So would you want the Discovery series to have more of the Enterprise and more of the original series kind of plot lines in it, or you want to just spin off an early the original series, just give us all the end, just give us the early Enterprise?
I want to see Pike and Spock go back to the Enterprise and
go on missions
and then have to help Discovery for some reason, maybe they tell Pike, the Admiralty calls in and says, "You got to get back to the Enterprise, blah, 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 something's going on." He and Spock have to rush back. Doesn't even really get to say goodbye to everyone. They're just they had to move very quickly. And then they just pivot the action for a half an episode to what's going on the Enterprise. And then they launch a new TV show with those two guys.
You would want to do that.
Yeah, and then they can interweave. The cool thing, though, is that because they exist in the same exact time as Discovery, they could... now we have another ship of other characters that we know that could be doing their thing. They could have two shows that are kind of weaving in and out of each other.
With Section 31.
And then with George, this could be amazing. Imagine having three different TV shows that are weaving in and out of each other. Mm-hmm. That could be really cool. Now, the writing is going to be hard to pull something off like that. But that is what they should do.
Mm-hmm. Just bite the bullet, reimagine the Enterprise, make it, update it.
Well, they did.
No, but the Enterprise.
No, we haven't seen it.
Well,
we
from the outside.
Yeah, we haven't seen
it. From the outside,
it.
I'm talking about I'm talking about really the bridge. Reimagine that bridge. Make it. I'll show Jay a picture.
Yeah, they have no problem updating stuff.
They haven't done that yet. They could have done it, and they didn't do it. And I think they're hesitant to do it.
Why? Why? If you think about it, the crew is different. The fact that it's on a ship that we know. I mean, other than sentimental value, I think it's cool that it's the early Enterprise. I think that's cool, but it's
they
not...
They should do to the inside what they do to the outside. It's close enough that it's recognizable.
Sure,
absolutely.
It's what it would look like with today's technology.
Look, we've gotten over it. Discovery is a modern version of that era. You know what I mean?
The tech that we're seeing inside Discovery is completely incompatible with the analog, time going by on the Enterprise
and
the original series.
And we saw that. Jay and I were looking at a picture of the bridge of the Enterprise. Classic Enterprise with an overlay.
Yeah, but that wasn't done by CBS.
That was just some digital artist. Yeah. But it was totally reminiscent and modernized.
Yeah, let's do it.
Just do it, and that's what I want to see.
It's what it would be if you had the technology to do whatever you want, which we now do.
Right.
So that they should just do it. I agree.
That's just so enticing to imagine.
What would you guys want?
I'd be happy with that. I think I'm totally down for an Enterprise spinoff.
Yeah, sure.
And even make it a limited run, two or three seasons.
Why even limit it?
I know. But if it's like, if it's too much.
There's what, 10 years of stories to tell? Now nine. Okay, 9 years of stories
to tell.
No, but
when does Pike get the acid bath or whatever happened to him?
Michael's mother said, "Hey, I know what happens to you. Yeah. You're not going to like it."
Oh my God! Right? Cool, yeah. But so what? Do 2 or 3 years, and then build. You can build up to Pike's big sacrifice, where he loses, you know, his skin and everything.
But we don't even know what happened to him.
Right. We don't.
There was a throwaway line in that show where he said there was an explosion on the thing.
They could make that a real moment. Right. They could turn that into him being a hero or something.
And I think they're actually going to try to make something like that happen in some respect. They're gonna. I think they said they want to sync up with the classic.
Yeah,
with
sync
the classic
up, which
show.
Means they're going to blow up Pike.
Right, so I think we are going to find out what happens to him in one way or the other. I don't know how involved he's going to be, but it's going to be this big thing, I think. But I just want to see the Enterprise.
Me too, Darren. Look, if they do that spinoff show, but the thing it's going to become my favorite Star Trek.
Oh my God!
Show.
As much as I love Discovery, I would lose my shit over that.
Yeah. So, but the thing is, though, the Pike blowing up happened pretty much right at the beginning of the original series.
Yeah, when Kirk. Got the
That's
Enterprise.
That's like years from now.
That's 9 years from
it's
now.
9 years from now. Yeah.
In the show.
It's
time.
Not like he's in that chair for 9 years. Then Spock decides to take him to Talos.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't know how confident you are.
But I'm pretty confident. I just saw the episode, you know, The Cage, pretty recently, and this is all recent events. What happened to Pike?
So we got 10 years.
Well, even if
well,
even
nine
if it's
now,
half that
so
time.
It had to be like 8 years from now.
Plenty of time to
okay,
have
eight
a TV
seasons.
Show.
Eight seasons. All right, I'm good with eight.
Yeah, but whatever, you get the point
whatever.
Is, when you say eight seasons, like, you know, like I said last,
year
last show.
So we had a series, Enterprise, with Captain April, right? Mm-hmm. Now we need Captain Pike, then we have Captain Kirk. We have to cover every captain of the Enterprise.
I totally agree. And just to finish my point from before, though, you know, a whole season of TV shows could be 3 weeks in Star Trek time, you know what I mean?
Or it could be 24 hours.
Yeah, exactly. So, okay, so we all mutually agreed that this episode was very good.
Yes.
It was a different kind of episode. It wasn't a beam down episode. It was more of a, it was like a thriller, psychological thriller type of thing, which was cool. It was different. I really enjoyed it.
Loved it.
A little bit of crying, but you were okay with that.
It started with crying. Bob goes, oh, they're crying right out of the gate. Michael's crying. I'm like, well, she's not a crybaby. You know what I mean?
No, not at all.
No, and I knew that it
great
was
actress,
it would be
my
short
God.
Lived. Yeah, her acting is, I feel time. Everything she, she's
I'd love to see her nominated, you know, and yeah. typically shows like science fiction, they're kids shows, so you don't want to nominate, you know, you don't want to give anybody the big awards because this is just science fiction. I hate that attitude.
Yeah. I'm super excited about the rest of the episodes for this season, and I'm really excited to see the potential of what's in front of us now. We have some really cool things. And the Picard show, like, let's not forget.
Oh, my God.
The Picard show, like, they're saying it's going to be much more philosophical. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not going to be, you know, beam down missions and stuff. It's going to be much more in his head and like, you know, seeing things from
we haven't heard anything about is he even on a ship or what's going on.
Just that it's going to be philosophical, you know, which I think
right,
is cool.
I'm ready.
I'm ready for it. So, okay, they're doing a much better job this season than last season.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah.
And hopefully this is, you know, is the show doing well? I mean, we have to find out how well. I know it's been picked up for season 3.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
They're already planning 3, and I think in terms of viewership, I think they're doing very well.
Yeah.
I don't have any hard numbers, but I think they're doing very well this season.
We already know that they're coming out with other shows and stuff.
Yeah.
If anything, they're loading the gun up to give us more Star Trek than we've ever had happening at the same time
Lower decks.
Before.
Lower
yeah.
decks.
Yeah, that's going to be great.
Rick and Morty writer, come on.
That could be
epic. Hilarious.
Yeah. Okay, and we're going to be here through all of it.
That's
so
right.
Check
Wait,
us out.
We're going to review all of that stuff?
Well, not necessarily episode by episode, but it's a lot of material for us to go
we
through.
We don't know the future. Bob, no one knows what the future is.
all we have is now.
Right now.
And right now, you should go to alphaquadrant6.com. That's alphaquadrant6.com. That's our website. Everything that we have is there. And of course, you can go to our YouTube and look at all the past episodes that we've done. Season 1, Season 2, Star Trek Discovery.
And all kinds of other science fiction as well.
Yeah, it's not just Star Trek. We love Star Wars and you know, any kind of science fiction.
We like both kinds, Star Trek and Star Wars.
you know,
country and West.
Hellboy's coming out.
Hellboy.
The new
reboot.
And it looks great. So I think what we should do is watch it and do a live stream on that.
It looks good.
If we can schedule it.
And of course, the elephant in the room. Infinity War. Oh, Endgame,
that, yeah, without a
that's
doubt.
Like as opening, soon as that comes out.
I'm saying opening night we should come back here without and review it.
I'll definitely see that in the theater more than once. Yeah. That movie's going to be awesome. They have
it
so much.
They have no choice.
They have so much.
No choice.
All right, we'll see you guys next week.